Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Sara Menker. I'm the founder and CEO of Grow Intelligence, which is an AI company focused on global agricultural markets. We're based in New York and in Nairobi, Kenya. And I'm going to talk to you about how AI is being used to transform global agricultural and food markets as we know it. So, headlines in January through May of 2019. There was a government shutdown. Kenya faced the worst drought in 38 years. There was over 1 million acres of cropland ravaged by floods, and actually, as of today, it's closer to 5 million acres. Ebola pig virus, it's called African swine fever, destroyed the swine population in China. About a third of it is gone. And there was a revolution in Sudan. Now, in all of these headlines, you actually see agriculture and food represented. That there is a headline that actually doesn't mention it, which is, in Sudan, the revolution was actually entirely driven by food prices. This chart that you see over here is a spike in sorghum prices in Sudan, which is the key grain that everybody essentially consumes. And here you had a devaluation in the currency. This is the revolution. The dates of the revolution are entirely tied to the price of food. This happens over and over and over again, and we have not learned to better understand and plan for our food and agricultural markets.
After calculating the estimates from various orange-producing states, we have concluded the following. The cold winter has apparently not affected the orange harvest.
So this scene is from the cult classic Trading Places with Eddie Murphy. This specific scene is when the U.S. government, the USDA, the Department of Agriculture, comes out and gives its report of the orange crop. And it does so once a month, and markets go completely crazy. Now, this is from 35 years ago. It still happens this way today. Nothing has changed. The process is manual. It's impossible to find the information you need. And so the markets, once a month, sit around and wait for a report to be issued by one government agency that essentially actually reports for the rest of the world, because nobody else even has this process in place. And it essentially leads to a lot of information asymmetry and inefficiencies in our global food systems. This is essentially how people used to not find information on agriculture. And I learned this firsthand when I used to trade energy, which is what my job was before I started this company. And then I tried to move into trading agriculture, and I realized how much more complicated it was than oil or gas or power or all these other commodities that we trade. And so what we decided to do was build an AI that's built on three key principles. Domain expertise. So for agriculture, you really need to know your stuff, meaning it's impossible to build an AI to solve such a complex real-world system without deep domain expertise. So we built a team that has expertise in hydrology, plant science, markets, geography, you name it. That lets us build depth, and depth is necessary. Again, agriculture is a complex real-world system. We think corn and wheat and soybeans and the few things that we hear about, but reality is there's tens of thousands of little commodities. There's vanilla and black pepper. The system is super complex, so you need depth in it because there's a lot of relationships between them. And the third is diversity. If you want to build an AI that essentially solves a complex real-world system, you need to actually build it on diversity so that it represents the world that you are then trying to represent. And so we essentially built the company on these three principles and our product on these three principles, and it's really reaped a lot of rewards for us. We've started to see the results and the successes that I think are truly driven by these three things. Now, why do we do it? I mean, when the US government shut down, we actually replaced the USDA. We, as a company of 65 people at the time, in a span of 1 week, generated 1,800 forecast models that were actually more than the number of models that the US government releases, automated the process, released it for free to the public. On January 11, There was no report from the U.S. government. So we were able to step in at noon and release these numbers through outlets like Bloomberg and Reuters, and essentially the markets continued. But the markets continued because we were able to do that. Now, we didn't do it because, you know, replacing the U.S. government is our goal. But it's one thing to remember that the U.S. is a very dominant player in global agriculture. And so what comes out of there really has ramifications everywhere else in the world. This chart that you see here is basically the amount of product of corn, rice, soybeans, and wheat. Just use that as a benchmark globally. As you can see in terms of volume, the U.S. and China are actually quite similar. But why the U.S. is dominant is because when you look at it on a per capita basis, your purple line is North America, and Asia is your green line. So yes, while on a total production basis, the amounts are equivalent, on a per capita basis, they're significantly lower. So what happens in the U.S. markets, the U.S. is a dominant player and so therefore has an impact on every other market. And these links are really complex to model. And having one gap like that can have all sorts of, you know, unintended consequences that feed through an entire system. So the world is much bigger. And the reality is the rest of the world doesn't have what I even described, which is the USDA process. So yes, that is a little bit still needs, you know, some improvement, some transparency, et cetera, but at least it exists. There are many parts of the world that we're generating forecasts for today, India, China, Russia, Kenya, South Africa, where you don't have that as an alternative. And to have automated models that are giving you signals on a continuous basis is really important to solve food security challenges. The world is much bigger than the US, right? And this is something that we forget. And this is really important, especially in the context of what's going on today. If you remember, I just mentioned to you that the floods that had 1 million acres of cropland ravaged about a month ago, that's now 5 million acres. That is the world's largest exporter of corn and soybeans. What this means to global markets when you are the dominant supplier and the rest of the world population is distributed like this is that this will have a ripple effect literally for probably 2 years. And we're just going to start to feel it. What happens in the next decade? The lines that are already high keep getting higher. You're flattening out in population, so this is looking at population across the world. And so you have regions like Asia and Africa that are growing the fastest, they're the youngest. But also, if you go back to this chart, they're also the two regions that are producing the least on a per capita basis. So how do we start to equalize production around the world, especially when we now live in a world where the world trade order is in complete chaos? Do you continue to depend on those same markets that you have brought, you know, food in from? Would you bet your entire population on that? Things have to change, but for things to change, we also can't rely on doing them the way we have done them before. We have to make them significantly cheaper. We have to make them more efficient. We have to make them more understanding, and we have to make them really transparent. And so what we did as a company is we realized that the world of agriculture, one thing to keep in mind is that it's very public. It's actually, because food is politics, most of the data around agriculture sits in the public domain. You can find it. But good luck using it. Good luck translating it. It's mostly in formats that are almost impossible to use. They're PDF files with scanned images, and then somebody throws handwriting and then moves the tables around. That's the way that most of the data is reported. But when you bring it all together, it gives you something super powerful. So we essentially harvest all of this data, and we make it go through an automated translation and transformation layer. And this is where you're actually doing language translation. And this is very domain-specific language translation, so it's actually really hard to use off-the-shelf tools for this. Once that's happened, kind of the key to what we do is our ontology. We've basically designed an ontology that where we can essentially index and classify this data to make it searchable, discoverable, way easier to use, it's normalized. And once it's normalized, it starts to give you insights like you've never had before. We're starting to understand a food system, an agricultural system that's been around since the Neolithic Revolution for the first time today. And it's kind of amazing because we're just getting started. And, you know, so we've built, as I said, all sorts of predictive models. We've taken a very unconventional approach in that we actually make all our methodology public, which has confused people. But the reason we did that is because we want to build trust. You cannot build trust in something that is so mission critical to the world without being open about how you're doing it. You can't just say, trust me, I got this, because no one's done this before. So you really have to take a humble approach to this process in some ways. And so we have an API that powers all sorts of products. That product can be visual. You can interact with it, you know, through voice, or you can even have chatbots. So depending on the complexity of what you want to do and who you are, is how do we help everybody better understand food systems, organizations that need it, but also individuals. So today, we're processing north of 55 million unique data series that come in multiple languages and formats. Think of this as each data series is basically a term that's defined in our dictionary. Agriculture, this is what I mean, that it's super complicated. This number was about 8 million at the start of last year. At the beginning of this year, it was about 40 million, and now it's actually north of 60 million as of today. And this continues to grow, because agriculture is not just food, it's weather, it's climate, it's our soil, it's people, it's culture. You know, as soon as you start to understand what drives it, the data that you need to model it gets wider and wider, more and more complicated. We're processing north of 650 trillion data points a day now. And this is why we're starting to generate some amazing insights that we just never had before in understanding and deconstructing our markets. So this is an example of AI and machine learning and grow, which is, you know, whether we're doing crop yield and supply forecast models where we're using a series of machine learning models to forecast in-season yield. So how much, you know, on any given day in India today, we, for example, for every county in India, we can tell you how much wheat is being produced. How do we do that? The first problem we actually have to solve is classification of crops. They don't tell you what fields grow what crop in India. And in India, unlike the US where a field is 50,000 acres, you have 2-acre plot and someone is growing potatoes, onions, wheat, and corn all side by side. So how do you start to classify those images to determine what field is growing how much wheat? From there, you can then start to do a supply model. And to do this for the whole country of India, it's like doing it for a continent. It's so complicated. We build drought models. So how do you better predict drought? We actually have flood models that helped forecast a lot of, so the markets today are using, we're the only company in the world today that has a forecast model that can tell you how much acreage is being destroyed due to a flood or to droughts. And you can do this real time, you can do this anywhere in the world. The other thing that really helped us is the automation of our mappings through neural networks. So when you're building a dictionary that's so complex, you cannot have humans sitting there doing that mapping. In the beginning, you need it. You absolutely need it, and this is where the human intelligence part comes in handy. We really are a company that was built on just brute force human intelligence to start, and then it was then taking that and mixing it and bringing together a team of technologists that had nothing to do with agriculture and getting them to work together. And this is what I mean by diversity. It's not just diversity of background, like, you know, where people are from or what they look like, it's diversity of thought. So how do you get people who are philosophers to work with engineers and computer scientists, market research analysts? And as I said, and this is really important because agriculture is an interplay between supply, demand, trade, and price. At the end of the day, every single person in the world wants to know where food prices are going. If you're a government, that's what you care about. If you're a company, that's what you care about. If you're a trader, that's what you care about. If you're a consumer, that's what you care about. But ultimately, that one signal that you get is an interplay between, I mean, thousands and thousands of models that underlie all of this. And so what we're building is this, we call it the you know, GROWS unified model of agriculture, but it's basically, think of it as building every single one of these models for every crop, for every region in the world. And so if you have a slight drop in pork production in China, The ramifications are everything from soybean prices in the US to what Brazilian farmers plant to do you now eat more chicken? If you eat more chicken, then the chickens now eat corn, they don't eat soybeans. I mean, it just starts to get. So how do you weave through that system and get an answer that tells you, do I produce more chicken? Are people going to eat more pork? Or do I eat more fish? Like, it's really complicated. And so building this interplay and understanding this interplay is really necessary if we are going to tackle the challenges that we have. You know, when we say food security, we kind of say it very blunt, like, you know, just like it's another term, but we always forget the second part of that term, security. It really is security. In most countries, food security is a national security matter. And somehow, these systems haven't been built for national security purposes, you know, let alone anything else. And so we really have to start thinking of it. So we cannot solve food security until we solve for this problem. And, you know, these supply, demand, trade, and prices are constantly disrupted. You have climate change that's getting in the way. You have demographic trends that shape, you know, what we eat and demand. But then that gets kind of mixed in with cultures and norms and softer things, you know. It doesn't mean that every population that's growing fast is going to eat more meat, because some populations don't. So what else are they going to eat? So how do you start to understand that? It's driven by socioeconomic trends. Then you have policy. And this year has been, last 2 years have been quite an example of how policy can be the biggest disruptor to markets as well. And we always forget that. We assume that policy makes markets function. Policy can also break markets. And then you also have just not so rational markets. And this is the thing you're fighting against. So modeling this in real time is actually quite necessary. And you don't start to solve and tackle issues and challenges and plan for the future without this. And the world that we believe is possible, the world that we work towards, is increased productivity, not just production. Meaning, let's not keep destroying our land and our forests to just keep producing more and more. Let's learn to produce more with less. And that's entirely possible. It's entirely possible. We need affordable food for all. We can't have Sudan happening over and over again and talking about it or not talking about it, which is even worse. We need less waste. Again, to optimize a system for waste, you need to understand what you're optimizing for. And then you need a healthier planet, both our earth, meaning we need to take care and better care of our soils and our water, but also our people. So if you want a healthier planet and healthier people, you really need a much more optimized food system. And this is just the beginning. Thank you.